Are you?
Yeah.
It looks good.
Oh my god, it's so bad.
It's hot.
No way.
Wait. You're 22?
How old are you?
Oh yeah, we were almost, we already had this conversation.
Like, well, people, where are you going?
You can't pick very my age. Fairly not.
Damn. Give me some sass.
Sassy?
And then. You want to.
Too far. I already sat down.
From what?
I'm coming.
Michael, I'm gonna take care of you. Sat down.
I'm going to be attending the training soon.
What's the day? Kevin.
Why?
Yeah.
I don't know. All I said here was 40.
I'm already here.
I know.
Maestro, can I open
tomorrow? What?
I know, I remember that last night. Yeah, Jory texted me.
Yeah, because she was talking to me. She's like, I feel like there's something doing nothing
soon. Yeah.
We're going to concert choir.
Yeah.
Yeah, I am. My piece is being played.
I'm fine. Because. Hi.
Sleep at night if I didn't talk a little bit about Vivaldi's Gloria. And then I mentioned Marc Anthony Charpentier in last class, French composer, who you guys need to know about. And we're going to watch snippets of videos of three composers today, which is Vivaldi, Charpentier, and Schubert, as we delve into classical. And I think Schubert is a good choice because even though he lived a very short amount of time, his initial output is very classical in sound. And then even just in his early 30s before he passed, his writing was extremely romantic. And that's similar to Beethoven. Beethoven had a classical kind of shape to his compositional output, and then it really transformed over the course of 60 plus years as opposed to 30 plus years, which makes Schubert and Mendelssohn that much more remarkable. Because I feel like those bridge composers who bridge classical to romantic, in just that short amount of time, their compositional output changed so drastically. So, can you review, please? This is, we're talking the Baroque bridge to classical. Okay. And can you give some approximate dates again for the Baroque?
1600.
Let's call it 1600 through 1750, right? Even though, of course, it's a little bit longer, okay? For sure. Bridge is like maybe 1750 to what? You know, 18, maybe even 20s-ish, okay? Yeah, that's a long time. It's 70 years, maybe 1800s. I would say that. And then classical is certainly, think about Mozart's dates. What are Mozart's dates?
1756 to 1791.
Yes, for sure. Okay, so think about 1756 to 1791. That's Mozart. Those are dates that you need to know. What are Bach's dates?
1685.
What are Handel's dates?
1685.
What are Mozart's dates?
1786 to
1791. What are
Beethoven's
dates? 1770. Very good. Having a strong class already. Okay. Those are dates that you need to know. Those are absolute dates that you need to know. What's Thomas Tallis's dates? 1505 to 85. Okay. How many do you have? You know, half dozen to a dozen dates of the biggies. Of the biggies. Why do I have you do this? For torture?
Yes.
Of course, for torture. Absolutely. Okay? No, because if you have a degree in music, people are going to expect you to know stuff, right? You can't just walk around saying music is cool and Mozart was cool and say he was a great romantic composer. Okay? Right? You can also give some approximate dates. And you could say 1770, 1827, 1756, 1791. What was happening in the middle of Mozart's life? What's that? He was living. He was drinking wine. What was happening? American Revolution, right? All that kind of stuff. 1770, right? Beethoven really caught as a six-year-old was, you know, had hearing from across the pond that we declared our independence, 1776. So those are tidbits that you can give to show that, yeah, you have some professional, you have a professional degree in music. Do you need to know Charpentier's dates? No. right? Do you need to know Rameau's dates? No. Right? Do you need to know approximately when the first organ was invented? I would like that. Do you need to know approximately when, yes, Patrick. The rules and traditions of, like, formal music was happening? Approximately, sure. And if someone says Mozart, yes. Handel, yes. Bach, yes. Beethoven, yes. Okay? Schubert, yes, minus one. Okay?
Mendelssohn, yes, minus one.
Okay? Classical time period. So what do we got classical? What have we been saying all semester?
1825.
Right? So these bridges are for sure are approximate, okay? So set 1825, and then we go boom, bridge into the Romantic time period. Okay? Alright, good. What are some of our classical composers that we know about?
Mozart.
Of course, Mozart.
Haydn.
Good. Who else? Yep, I'm going to call them bridge composers. So, Schubert. Okay, and Beethoven. Okay, bridge composers into the Romantic time period. Okay, awesome. Who are some Baroques that we've talked about? Of course, Bach, Handel. Who else? Who is the underrated hero of the Baroque time period?
Telemann.
Okay. Right? Who else did we talk about? French. What? Bucks. Who is? Frank Clement. Bucks. And we got Sharp. Okay? Charpentier. Okay? Good? Bridge composers, this guy could be there for sure. Absolutely. Going towards the classical. Okay? Alright. What was going on with instruments? Instruments are getting bigger. Voices are getting bigger. Concert halls are getting bigger. Opera houses are getting bigger. Secular music is more and more and more in play. What was Handel's biggest contribution to the musical world?
Messiah.
Messiah, good. And Messiah is an example of what kind of genre?
Oratorio.
Oratorio. Remind me some of the characteristics we've talked about in an oratorio. If I said, I'm going to go see an oratorio and I've never been to one, how can you translate what that means to me? Sammy.
It's... First, it's sacred. It's basically a non-stage version of the opera. It doesn't involve costumes, elaborate sets. It's way cheaper. People could watch it during is it like religious holidays?
Where? Why couldn't they go to an opera during religious holidays?
Because they were secular.
Yes.
Yes.
Good. Yeah, for religious times, like
yes.
Advent and Lent, several weeks worth. Alright? What would I do with my life if I didn't have the opera? Okay? What else is characteristic of an oratorio? What components make up an oratorio? James?
So, you have an orchestra or some sort of instrumental forces, and then voices, several voices, some solos. Recitative and aria.
Who does those?
Soloists.
Recitative. That is a multi-syllable word that I've never heard of before. It sounds like a cool word to say. What does it mean?
Recitative is... It's... It helps to move the plot along. It's more of... It's lots of words in very little time. And it's... more rubato, so the tempo fluctuates and the accompaniment tends to be a little bit more sparse than in aria.
I love it. What's a better word he could have chosen instead of rubato? The tempo is not necessarily rubato. I believe it's rubato, but there's a better word even.
It's unmetered.
Unmetered, that's another good word, yeah, for sure.
Well, like speech.
Speech-like. Speech-like. So it goes with the flow of the vernacular language. Very good. And you say instruments, I'm confused. What do you mean instruments? Smaller groups of instruments?
Yeah, if I recall correctly, basso continuo and maybe a couple other instruments, but not like the full orchestra.
Uh-huh. And basso continuo, right? This is a continuo group, okay? And what's, especially in the Baroque, what's a continuo group consist of?
Organ.
Okay? Organ, or a better answer is?
Keyboard.
Okay.
some kind of a bass instrument, which could include
viola da gamba.
Viola da gamba.
Viola da gamba is more of a solo instrument. So what's
right? More of a solo instrument because it's got multiple strings and frets and it's amazing, right? What is its cousin?
The cello.
The cello. Boring old cello. Okay.
So the cello. What else is another bass instrument?
Bassoon, right? B-S-N. And then what else could be a bass instrument?
Theorbal.
And what is a theorbal? That's a really fun word to say too.
It's a super lute.
It's a super lute. I love it. Bob?
It goes forever. It's a good. It's like it has bass strings and then it has a lower treble. And it has like 6, 8 strings.
A lower treble?
No, it's like it's lower down.
You see how confused
the strings are longer when they're the bass notes.
Ah, okay. So it has a lute plus
long bass notes.
Long bass notes. And can you be more specific about the bass notes? It's quite simple. From C to shining C. Right? Octave C's goes from C, D, E, F, G, A, B, C in the bass. So you go C, D, E, F, G, A, B, C. And that's what's on the long neck of the lute. So you can go bong. Remember a weird demonstration several weeks ago?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Bong. Bong. While that's sustaining. Accompany yourself, essentially. Okay? It's a great one-stop shopping instrument. Okay? Continue a group. So, and then what else is missing? We have a keyboard, we have some kind of a bass instrument that's joining us, and then we have a soloist. Okay? And that's usually a voice. Okay? And then the viola da gamba, for example, is a wonderful, wonderful solo instrument for during a instrumental passage. Okay? Ariel.
To add on the solo.
Yes.
Arias.
Thank you. What are arias?
They're more of like
eventually. I'll buy that. I'm not getting it. I don't get it, Ariel.
It's more of an artistic way instead of trying to speak.
I think recitative is perfectly artistic. Michael.
It's a segment where the soloist can show off their voice with fewer texts and texts are repeated. And so it's double the time, half of aria.
Oh, you said something when you said something. So it's shorter text that can be repeated, right? And then you said something about, take your
da capo,
da capo, okay? And what does that mean?
It's go back to the top, so it's the same through, fairly the notes as written, and the second time the da capo part, they would have freedom to improvise ornaments.
Oh my gosh, that sounds like it's so long. Oh, gosh, like days. Jake, help me better understand. Turn me on to a da capo aria.
Okay, so it's an A, B, A prime form. The whole thing isn't necessarily repeated. Just the first section, when it comes back to that, you kind of remember it from the first time, but you're listening to the cool new stuff they're doing from the melody line. That's where the vocalist shines.
Good. So when I hear the return, I should be like my family was when I first came to Messiah. Okay, bless their hearts. Good. This is really good. So oratorio, my friends, this is a biggie. This is as big as, what are there some other genres earlier than oratorio?
Motet.
What else?
Magical.
What else?
Chanson.
Right? What else? Anthem. Good. So these are biggies. And oratorio in the Baroque time period has this kind of characteristics, where now we go into classical, okay? And it's less about continuo groups. Now we have strictly full orchestra, soloists. Boom. Right? And bigger instruments, bigger halls, bigger voices, bigger forces. Right? Instead of a violin section of maybe 6, okay, there's a violin section of 9 to 10. Okay? And if we were talking about a classical orchestra, you know, maybe it's 6, 6, 3, 3, 1, you know? And then a romantic orchestra is heading towards 10, 10, right? Let's call it 6-ish, let's call it 6-ish, and maybe even 8 basses down in there, okay? This is probably 10-10, maybe even 10 here. 6 to 10, you always, okay? There's a joke in there somewhere.
But the idea is everything's growing bigger. What's up with the classical orchestra we talked about in class? Quick review. What does, after you look past the strings, what other instrumentation is involved in a classical orchestra?
Brass.
Winds? Yeah, what kind of winds?
Brass.
Good. Classically speaking, what type of brass are we talking about? Jessica?
Well, there's less than romantic, right? So there would be maybe like one trombone and no tuba,
okay.
Right?
No tuba, why not? Wasn't invented yet.
Yeah, okay.
Right? Good. What else? The
French horn.
French horn? Sure, there's some French horn. Less common, but yes. Okay. What's another big one? Symphony is percussion, yeah, Tim. That's pretty much the what's beyond the strings. Okay? What's another big one here in the brass?
Cornet.
Trumpet. Okay? Trumpet. Meaning it's trumpets. Trombones. Mozart used trombones a lot. So if I'm a trombonist, I'm psyched when I hear this from Mozart program. Mozart Requiem uses a little baby trombone, a medium-sized trombone, and a bass trombone. It's really fun, okay? A lot of his Missa Brevis and his little smaller pieces use three trombones as well. But normally, it's typically timpani and trumpet, or timpani, bones, and trumpets, okay? What are the woodwinds? What do we say about the woodwinds?
Clarinet.
Clarinet, good.
Brass.
Flutes. Oboe, and bassoons. And what did we say about these guys?
They travel in pairs.
They travel in pairs, right? Because otherwise they'll get gobbled up by the string instruments. Okay. So they're pairs. So whenever you think of a classical orchestra, pairs of winds, right? Perhaps even two trumpets, two to three trombones. But the winds, these woodwinds, pairs. Okie dokie. Strings and pairs. That would be a good answer to on a test. How do you describe a classical orchestra? Okay. Oratorio now becomes more of a concert, less of an intimate continuo group. The cool thing about a continuo group is that in a smaller acoustic, they can still be heard. So in a larger acoustic, the continuo group goes away because the people in the last seats wouldn't be able to hear it necessarily. Practical, right? Very practical. All right. Cool. Great. We are going to go to all of these.
And so we're going with like 6 to 10 for violin.
When?
Classical.
Classical would be between 3 to 6, right? So small, still smaller than. Stop. Good. So. That is a hint of Vivaldi Gloria in a moment. Love that noise. At least it wakes up the people who have been sleeping, right? Some of our resident sleepers aren't even in class today.
They're sleeping.
Maybe they are. Maybe they're no longer in residence. They're just off campus sleeping. We're going to listen to the first movement of the Vivaldi Gloria, and you're going to talk to me about it. Okay, Vivaldi is a very, very famous composer, and what country does he sound like he's from?
Italy.
Italy, that's a good guess, okay? And exactly right. He, prolific career, one of the more famous. People would sometimes call him conservative. Some people called him the Palestrina of the Baroque time period, because Palestrina was accused of being conservative as well, because he was trying to salvage polyphony from the powers that be. His most famous piece, hands down, is his Gloria in D major. Okay? This first movement is all over D major. What is the scoring that you see here? Can you see?
You think it's more famous in the four seasons?
I think, well, if you're going to say that, then it's probably his most famous choral orchestra, hands down. Okay, Four Seasons are probably right up there. Okay, but I think the non-vocalist would say Four Seasons for sure. Okay, James.
So, looks like for, I don't know what tromba is, but I'm going to guess that's flute or something.
Okay.
And then, I don't know, you have oboe, violin, two violins, viola, voices, and then bass and cello, probably doubling. What is trauma?
It's trumpet.
Is it trumpet?
Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. And what language?
Is it Italian?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. So the idea is tromba. So why on earth do you write the trumpet up there?
Just the high part.
The high part. Yeah, I would say. So we know score order. Those of you taking conducting, you know score order. Modern score order. Score order, okay? Score order. The idea is that it's okay. It wasn't always such, okay? And in this edition, he chose to put the trumpet on top, okay? And also, he's missing eventually the timpani part later. But yes, this is what the cello sees, and this is also what the bass sees, okay? Except they play, it sounds an octave lower.
Does it stand for basso continuo?
Yes. So the basso continuo is then the keyboardist would reduce using that bass line. Okay? And it's nice to put the voices above, right? Because then they can harmonize the right hand from the voices. Okay, so the bass is in the left and the harmony is in the right hand. Okay? And then if you're really good, if the voices weren't there, as long as they could see the violins, then they could harmonize. If there weren't any figures in the figured bass. Okay? So there it is. Okay, so Vivaldi, Gloria. What do you know about a Gloria? I know that piece.
It's a good one.
It's a good one. What other Glorias do we know? John Rutter has a very famous Gloria for brass and choir and organ. Awesome. Rock your socks. Mozart wrote a Gloria. Yeah, one piece. Yeah. Yeah, for sure. Not his most famous piece, however.
We're talking Coronation Mass.
Coronation Mass is right up there. What do you know about a Gloria?
Mass.
Part of a Mass. Bravo. Okay. But what's cool about sacred? What's cool about this is that this he wrote a Gloria that stands by itself. This is not attached to any Mass. Just like the Rutter Gloria is not attached to any Mass. Okay. This is a 40-minute, 35-ish minute piece. If your tempo are pretty sprightly, and this is the first movement of it. That only deals with the text of the Gloria. Now, what do we know about the text of the Gloria as far as length is concerned?
Short.
Okay. Does anyone disagree? I would hope so. Yes. What is the longest movement of a Mass?
Credo.
Credo. We believe in a lot of stuff. Okay. The second longest movement in a Mass, folks, is the Gloria. It has the second most amount. What has the least amount?
Kyrie.
Yeah. What's pretty darn close to having the least amount as well?
Benedictus.
Benedictus and? Sanctus is a little longer, but yes.
Agnus
Dei. Agnus Dei, right? So what's the longest movement in the Mass, text-wise?
Credo.
What's the second longest?
Gloria.
Right. Gloria to God in the highest and peace to his people on earth. Several stanzas. Okay. If you're on an I something, look it up right now. Look up the Gloria, or look up Mass text, and you'll see right now, you'll see. So, Gloria has a lot of text to it, a lot of text. So if you are a performer and you pick up the Gloria, you are buckling in. You're saying, okay, this is going to be longer, most likely, okay, unless you omit some words. If you're picking up a Credo, it's often why, oh, I was going to bring this up next week, but jot this down in your notes, would you mind? An important genre in this classical time period was called Missa Brevis. Missa Brevis. What does that mean?
Short
Mass. Missa Brevis.
Short Mass?
Short Mass. How did you get that, Jake?
Because it sounds like that's what it would mean. Like the brevity of life. Short, I don't know.
Brevity?
Word association is what you mean.
Thank you. Word association cognates. Brief. Brevity. Missa brevis, a short or reduced size Mass. Okay? During Mozart's time, the priests and powers that be were getting upset because
music was being so extravagant, becoming so extravagant, and it was kind of overshadowing the worship service at times. And they said, wait a minute, wait a minute, wait a minute. We gotta have our stuff be prominent and musical and enhance it, but I feel like I'm attending a concert as opposed to a church service mass. Okay, fine. So what they do, and I don't want my mass to be 3 hours long. I want it to be half of that, an hour and a half now, please. Thank you very much. And so composers were forced to write and invent what we call missa brevis. And they would maybe set the Kyrie, maybe the Gloria. They would skip the Credo often. Why do we skip the Credo? Does that mean we don't believe in anything? Of course not. So what happened during the service is they would speak the Credo. They would speak the Credo. Knock that out in less than a minute as opposed to 10 minutes, right? And then they would have a short version of a Sanctus Benedictus and go right to the Agnus Dei. There's a famous story that Mozart was getting upset by this. And he wrote this particular Missa Brevis, B flat. And it's Kyrie, Gloria, Kyrie, Gloria, Sanctus, No Benedictus, and Agnus Dei. And he was told by the priest after the first performance of it that his Agnus Dei was too long. So what he did was he went back and he reduced the Agnus Dei. But you think about the Agnus Dei text, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Dona nobis pacem. Right, that's the only change. Three lines of text in the Agnus Dei. Okay? And so what he did was he took the Dona nobis pacem and extended the Dona nobis pacem. Right. So it's like, it's great. It goes, Dona nobis pacem, Dona nobis pacem. That's essentially the tune. Okay. And what he did was, he's like, I'll bring in the class because it's hilarious. But it's like, pacem. They give him a little stop, and then he changed the key. Dona nobis pacem. Pacem, 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 pacem. Like he's literally going like this to the priests. It's fantastic. Fantastic. So what he gave, you know, he gave the nana, nana, nana. So he made his Agnus Dei short, but he made the Dona nobis pacem long. Okay? So, Missa Brevis. Hopefully you'll never forget that. It's an important genre in choral orchestral music. And it was invented to be practical, to reduce the size and length of a mass. Okay? And they would skip the longest music. Sometimes Kyrie, sometimes Gloria and Credo would be skipped if you really wanted to get through it fast. Okay? Lovely, lovely pieces of music that you could definitely program for high school age and intermediate to beginning college age for sure. Jake.
A few weeks ago I was listening to 104.9 and I hear the word to Gloria and Excelsis Deo. And I'm like, oh, this is a Gloria. And then when I was over to Vivaldi, she said it was Vivaldi's In Excelsis Deo. Is that a real thing, or did she screw up?
She screwed up.
Should I write them?
Call the bitch. Write them a letter.
I was also like, oh, I totally know what this is. I'm like, what?
Fair enough. Okay. So, anyway, so this piece, this is just the first movement. It's a couple minutes long. And I like it because you can actually watch the music and listen to it at the same time. And we'll listen to further along movements once I find them. And I have a new tab. So, yes, D major all the way around. Kind of hammers it home with octaves. This piece is schlepped on a regular basis. It's kind of like Messiah. Like, I've sung more bad performances of Messiah in my first 20 plus years of existence than in the last now 15 years of my life. I've sung amazing performances of Messiah and Vivaldi's Gloria, and I love those pieces so much. So I encourage you to fall in love with this piece and do it really, really well at any level that you can, and because it's just music that speaks to the soul. Okay? First movement. Sorry.
Thank you.
of the movement set to music takes 2 minutes and 11 seconds at that tempo. Interesting, isn't it? Right? And... Stop.
next movement. Solo movement. Duet movement. One of the more famous duets. Super, super fun. It's a really subtle option. It's a great, easy high school level as well, but done really, really well at professional level too. Famous.
Some instances of like a, seem like a xylophone or marimba in there. Would that be the piano right here, the basso right hand?
I think it's a product of the recording.
Okay.
Right. So because I was hearing it too, it sounds like some kind of melodic instrument. I think it's just the recording. Okay. Good ears. Okay. So now one more movement, and then we'll move to Charpentier and hear some French. Stop it.
Get out of it.
I don't want that to be there. Escape.
Maybe try to the light part in the middle first, because it might try to
be like it. Brilliant. Thank you. So, do a quick analysis of this. Homophonic? Polyphonic? What's your first power chord? Good. Say the notes that you see from the bottom up. Go. Are you hearing? I'm hearing C. Why am I hearing?
I said that note.
Okay, that's a confession. Right? Good. So, what chord is your power chord?
E
minor. Very good. How about on the syllable of agimus? Ah. Agimus.
C major
in
first
inversion. Instability. What about T B? T. What notes do you see? What notes do you see? A sharp, B,
G sharp,
C sharp. Right? Is there a definitive chord that you can make out of that? Not necessarily, so we'll call that tension. What's B? Same score, right? Tension.
Yeah.
And then what about gracias? Gracias. What do you see?
A, F sharp, C, so F sharp.
On the syllable of gra. Sorry, this one.
I missed. How about
that? Yeah.
D major.
Right? Alejandro nailed it. D major with what?
No.
This is the culprit.
It says it's B dominant 7 inversion.
Sorry.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. Right? B dominant 7, right? Because it's got the A and the 7th in the base, right?
Yeah.
Okay? So final inversion. Okay? So just at first blush, you're going to hear like minor and then instability and then tension, even more instability, right? Before you even open your face or pick up your bow. Okay? Good.
Ready.
Not having the instructions was really, really disconcerting. And I was like, but I don't know if I'm doing it right. I don't know if I'm doing it right. The more listening I do, just like jazz, the more listening that you do, the more it becomes instinctive. Okay? And you'll see, it's on the page. Are you guys too young enough to know, what was that Prego commercial? It's in there. It's in there, right? It's in the music. Right? Bach and Handel and Vivaldi and all the great ones. It's built in. Dynamics are built in. And it takes just a little different part of the brain to really comprehend that on the fly especially. Okay? But don't let a lack of instructions, what we think is a lack of instructions, deteriorate your creativity of musicianship. Okay? So they added a really nice, beautiful crescendo there because of the musical tension. Okay? Good choice. Very famous. Sets the stage. Gracias, Adimus TV. Gracias, Adimus TV. Cut. It's a little bit of a fugue. Yeah?
Is that just a B major 7 chord that ends that whole thing?
Yep. No.
Is he B major and then the tenor voice has that A sharp?
Misprint.
Really?
Yeah. That's a misprint. Right? That doesn't make any sense whatsoever.
It did because the first chord sounded...
Oh, sorry. Sorry. A sharp is enharmonically what? No. No, that doesn't make any sense, does it?
I mean, I don't mind a B major 7 chord, but it doesn't...
No. It should not be at all. It should not be at all. Yeah. That's a misprint.
Is it just
B minor TB? That should be, what should it be?
B major?
B major. So I think tenor should be singing TB, just like the basses. Okay? B major. B, D sharp, F sharp. Cool. Interesting. Okay? So again, don't trust necessarily what's always online, because people do make mistakes. Okay? Alright. Here we go. It sets the stage for this little fugue coming up.
Okay.
it's like a 2-minute fugue. It's like a mini fugue. And it's really cool and upbeat and fun to sing. It can be definitely sung by beginning, intermediate, advanced high school, certainly a church choir, certainly a community choir, and obviously a professional choir. I've seen it done at a middle school age, and there's actually a new version in the last 5 years of Vivaldi Gloria for just women. Okay? And so I would say that it's a pretty good find, and it's a wonderful, wonderful rendition of this. And it's actually in Vivaldi's hand. They found it for Vivaldi, because Vivaldi worked for an all-girls school. Okay? So a lot of girls were employed, and he wrote for women who were extremely capable musicians during a time when that was not necessarily looked upon as socially acceptable. Okay? Cool. All right, let's look back here. Awesome.
Excuse me, Dr. Wallace?
Yeah.
How long is it all?
30 minutes. 25 to 30 minutes max.
Thank you.
baroque music. And I want you to notice, the subtlety of the Latin. They're using a French dialect, so Te Deum, La Damis, and they're using more Frenchy sounding vowels on certain, to add certain flavor to the Latin. Okay? If you're a bass or a baritone, and you get contracted to do a charpentier Te Deum, it's like, yes! Because if you can't get pumped up after that big, big instrumental introduction, and then all of a sudden it's you and trumpets and timpani at the beginning, right? You can't get more excited about it. It's so much fun to sing. And so, definitely, you bang on some stuff, and then you play a lot of brass, and then all of a sudden the bass gets some...
Thank you. feast of the Charpentier Te Deum. You should definitely have it in your life. I have a lot of Charpentier. He wrote a beautiful little Christmas mass, Messe de Noël. It's beautiful, 20 minutes long or so for similar forces. Lovely for church choirs, school choirs, community and certainly professional. Now, Schubert. Schubert wrote, I think, four distinguishable masses. One in F, one in G, one in A flat, and one in E flat. And the first two are of the classical ilk. They definitely sounds like Mozart. Sounds like string quartet man. And short, sweet, charming. His masses in A flat and E flat are more Beethoven, Mendelssohn, romantic, larger scale works, larger orchestras, romantic gestures, chromaticisms, you name it. The Schubert Mass in G is the second Mass, the Mass in F first, bless you, and then he wrote the Mass in G next, it's the second Mass, and this is an example of Kyrie and Gloria, and you see that it's quite accessible, and that's not necessarily a cop-out or an apology, it just makes it practical. I sang this piece when I was in high school, for example. This is often a piece that I have my conducting class learn in the second semester, for sure. But the idea is that it's still beautiful music. It's a beautiful music. And this is a complete mass, so all five main movements are represented. And this is the Kyrie, and I think the Gloria as well.
Thank you.
charming.
We never performed this. We played it, right? So we performed this, right?
No.
I thought we did a couple years ago.
No. Before my time, maybe?
No, because I came the year you did. It's just, it sounds so familiar.
Mozart
like
Coronation Mass.
Oh.
For sure. Right?
That's weird.
Yeah. Same text.
It's like,
same
I swear
style.
We played it, yeah.
Yeah, for sure. We might have busted it up and did that thing out. I can't remember. But that's a typical one for at least when I was at Junior Mass. So, okay. Good. What was I going to say? Oh, so now the Gloria movement. We'll wrap it up for today. This is the Gloria from Schubert's Mass in G. Okay? And it's peppy, brilliant, fun, super. A little bit of fugues, a little bit of duets. Fun.
Yeah,
Right. So what I've been doing is all my books, I take them a picture of
them.
Oh, okay. So
I'm gonna take
books.
Just like cry the whole day.
Thank you. Oh, you're recording? Somebody. Ta-da. Harold, yeah? Uh-oh. Yeah?
Are you busy right now?
No.
You want to be my, like, my fake student?
Is it?
My fake students.
Sure.
Pair of students.
So we're practical.
Yeah. This is my, like, the third semester one.
Okay.
We're teaching choral.
And this is, you're teaching the 246 class, right? Or is this just, is it teaching the 246, or is it just teaching fellow 346?
It's 246 and the 346. Or whoever, we're all going to be in the same classroom.
Yeah, sure.
I'll be right back. The more I practice this, the more it like feels like I know. Because I literally almost, like, you know how it's 15 minutes, right?
Yes.
So it's literally like, it's literally, my lesson ends like around 14:30.
Ooh, well.
And I need to pace right, because I'm doing like all these steps that like will give me brownie points. And it's just like I'm trying to also practice with, like, if they don't get something, like, as much as, like, as I want to be on, like, I could be on time with the way I talk, like, if there's, like, error detection, things I have to spend,
if you catch something and you,
like, we have to spend time on it, that takes extra time.
Yes, it does.
So, that's fine. I could just be fun.
It's good that you're thinking that way. With that being said, be prepared to never actually finish your lesson.
Oh, no, I know. I mean, I cut my song in half. We're only singing back.
Okay.
You want to...
However you want me... Okay. Is this class for you to be a grade? Oh, this people to be a grade, or...
This is 8th grade.
8th grade, okay.
Yeah.
Alright. Are we saying advanced? Advanced choir?
This is like a mixed.
Mixed, okay.
So, people know and some people don't. Just because we're all music majors, that they were told not to like act like they're like stupid.
It gets me. It puts things in perspective, at least for me.
Yeah. But I mean, like they said, like, don't act like you're that young. You should use your own knowledge. You should actually use your knowledge.
Okay.
Okay. Or I'll keep it up from here. So that. Alrighty, class. So remember last time we met, we were talking about rounds, and we were working on some songs that were about rounds, like the Row Row Your Boat warm-up we had, the Buck About Cannon we sung,
mm-hmm.
And then we also were talking about different music from different time periods, like Renaissance and the Baroque. So who could remind us what a round is? Russell.
When one person starts with a song, and then another one comes in at the beginning, and it just keeps on going.
No, you're on the right track. So basically, it's we're all singing the same line, but we're coming in different times of the song. And so today we are going to sing that kind of song again. However, since last time we were talking about the Renaissance period, who knows what comes before the Renaissance period? And you're learning it right now in your world history classes, Russell.
Gregorian chant.
You're in that era.
Gregorian chant.
Medieval, yeah. Yeah, exactly. So the medieval period. And in that time, there were two main types of music. There was more on one side than the other. And that first one was sacred music. And sacred music was basically music of the church. And then, however, there was another type of music which was not as common, but it existed, which was called secular. And it was the opposite of what sacred music was. Who could give a guess what secular might mean if it's the opposite of sacred?
Not sacred.
Not sacred, exactly. So just kind of music of the people. And so today we're going to look at a piece that is from the medieval era, and it is a secular piece. So you see the piece in front of you, it's called Summa Risicuminim. Can we say that? Summa Risicuminim. And this practically means summer is coming. And so I'm going to demonstrate the piece for you so you can hear what it, how it sounds. And then we'll dive right into the piece. Sumer is a cumenin, ludus in cuckoo. Grow with med and blow with med and spring the wood anew. Sing cuckoo. Alrighty. Oh, before we get to the text, however, who can tell me what the time signature is?
6:08.
And Sarah. Sarah, what does 6:08 mean? We've done this before last week. We did that sailor song.
Six beats in a measure and an eighth note equals a beat.
Exactly. So we're doing things and covering things that we've done before, right? Just familiar things. So let's get into the text. So I'm gonna speak it first, and you're gonna repeat after me. We're gonna speak, sing this in rhythm. Summer is ecumene. Ready, go.
Summa is a kumeni.
Awesome. Let's do the kumeni again. And do this with your head. Kumeni. Kumeni. So it's three below the min. All right. And the next part. Ludasin kuku.
Ludasin kuku.
Grow with sed and blow with med.
Blow with sed and blow with med.
And spring the wood anew.
And spring the wood anew.
Sing cuckoo.
Sing cuckoo.
Awesome. So, before we move on with that, let's see the translation. The first part, summa risicuminim. Russell, what does that translation say underneath?
Summer is coming.
Exactly, just like the title. And Jessica, what does ludasin cuckoo mean?
Ludasin cuckoo.
Awesome. Next, grow sed and bloweth med rhyme. What does that say underneath, before the comma?
The seed is growing and the meadow is blooming.
Exactly. And then next, and spring the wood anew, Bradley.
And the wood is coming into.
It sounds a little weird, but basically it's just saying the trees are growing leaves. And lastly, as it looks, sing cuckoo. All right, now let's do and speak, sing, and rhythm again, but let's do a larger chunk. Let's do that first top part. Me first, then you.
Summer is a kumeni, luda sing cuckoo.
Summer is a kumeni, luda sing cuckoo.
Let's do that again. Let's go actually take it a little slower. I'll do it slower so you can hear, okay? Me first, alright?
Summer is a kumeni, luda sing cuckoo.
Summer is a kumeni, luda sing cuckoo.
Nice, that was much better. Now let's move on to the next part. Me first.
Grow with sed and blow with med and spring the wood anew.
Grow with sed and bloom with med and spring the wood anew.
Let's see that word again. Is it blow with med or blow with med?
Blow with.
Yeah, exactly. And the last part.
Sing cuckoo.
Sing cuckoo.
The easiest part. Alright, so let's try doing this all together, each line to the very end of the middle. Alright, I'm going to do it with you first time, and the second time you guys can do it yourselves.
Are you singing?
No, we're still speak, singing, and rhythm. Ready, go.
Sumari zikumeni, ludising cuckoo. Grow with med and blow with med and spring the wood anew. Sing cuckoo.
Oh, that sounded great. Now I want to hear just yourselves, alright? Alright. Ready, set.
Sumari.
Ready, go.
Suma is ikumeni, luda sing cuckoo. Grow with sed and blow with med and spring the wood anew. Sing cuckoo.
Awesome. The only thing I could find there is that you said, oh no, you did that just correctly. The words you didn't mix sed and med. Alright, so the next part we're going to do is we're going to add melody chunk by chunk. So. It's going to be me first, and then you repeat after me. I'm going to play the piano for the women. So women, when you hear the piano, try to match your timbre to this. And men, match your timbre to my voice, all right?
So many.
Let's hear that again. So sumer is going down, right? So we go
sumer is.
Repeat after me. Do this with me.
Sumer is.
Yeah. So let's try that again. Ready, go.
Sumer is in kumeni.
Yeah. All right. That was much better. Now it's the next part.
Luda sing cuckoo. Luda sing cuckoo.
That was great. Alright, next part.
Roll with sed and blow with med.
Roll with sed and blow with med.
Let's hear that again.
Roll with sed and blow with med.
So it's, what is that? Is it the same note?
Blow with med. The same note.
Yeah, exactly. So we're going to stay on that same note when we go down, right? All right, let's do that one more time.
Roll with sed and blow with med.
Roll with sed and blow with med.
Yeah, that was much better. So let's move on to the next part. And spring the wood anew.
And spring the wood anew.
Yeah, let's do that. I think you could do much better than that part.
And spring the wood anew.
And spring the wood anew.
Yeah, nice. And the next last part.
Sing cuckoo. Sing cuckoo.
Nice. Alright, so let's do this again in bigger chunks. So I'm going to actually sing with you instead of have you sing it alone for each line, alright? Alright, so.
Sumeri zikumeni in lude sing cuckoo. Sumeri zikumeni in lude sing cuckoo.
Let's listen to that part again.
Lude sing cuckoo. Lude sing cuckoo.
On the lude sing, the sing is only a half step. So let's do this one more time. Sumer is coming.
Sumer is a kumeni.
Let us do it one more time. Together. Ready, go.
Sumer is a kumeni. Lude sing cuckoo.
Okay. And so the next part, sorry, I went a little ahead. The next part sounds like this.
Roll with sed and blow with med and spring. Spring the wood anew.
And next last part.
Sing cuckoo. Sing
so let's do this all together. It sounds like it's coming together, so let's try to do this all in one shot.
And I'll sing with you the first time, and next time you guys are singing on your own, right?
So, ready, go.
Sumerise cum enin lunis syncum row with med and blow with med and spring the wood anew. Sing cuckoo.
Awesome, that sounded great. I messed up on that set. I said med first. I apologize. But let's, on that grow it set, it was a little misty there. So let's review one more time.
Row with sed and blow with med. Row it, set, and blow with med.
Yeah, that was much better than what I heard earlier, alright? Alright, so let's sing it in, let's do it one more time, and I want to hear you all alone, alright?
Three.
And this is your York.
Alright, ready, go.
Summa is a kumeni in ludisim. Row it, set, and blow with med, and spring the wood anew. Sing cuckoo.
Awesome. Looks like you're getting the hang of it, right? So, we're going to try doing this in two parts. So, you guys, I want you guys to be group two, and we're going to be group one right here, right?
Is it time?
I have 13 minutes. I want to see how you direct to me. All right, so before we get into the round, we're going to do this little exercise. So you were group one, right? And you're group two. Let me ask you guys, where do you guys enter?
Beginning.
And you have that circle number one, right? And group two, you have that circle two, right? With a two. So group two, a trick question, where do you begin? Not at the two, right? At the beginning. So let's do this exercise. Group one, we're going to start first, but we're going to stop once group two enters. So we stop at measure three, they enter it at measure three at the beginning. So, us first, so ready, go.
Sumerise cum enim.
Yeah, awesome. So that's what I want us to do, but next we're going to just stop at the third measure, all right? And listen for them to come in. Alright, so ready, go.
Sumeris in Kumeni. Sumeris in Kumeni.
Awesome. So, I want group two, both of you actually, look up at me so I can give you your cues and I can give you your cutoffs at the end. So now I think that we got that. Let's go ahead and dive in. Let's try to do the round into. I'll be group two this time. Alright, let's give us our note. Fresh C. Ready? Go.
Sumanis a kumani. Sumanis a kumani. Road is set and blow with med and sing. Row is set and blow with med and sing.
Now, I want you guys to watch out, and on that last two, this notes right here, on that major chord in Spring the Woo. Remember we've been listening to major and minor chords? That is your major chord.
At Spring the Woo de Noo.
The major chord, and the steps, and then down. Alright. So let's do that again, and I want you guys to think tall vowels. I want them tall vowels from you guys. I want some big kids singing. One, two.
Sumerise cum enim. Sumerise cum enim.
Lourdes sed et blow with med.
Row with sed
et
blow with med.
Awesome! So next class we're going to finish the last half. And then we're going to split into two more parts. All right, see you next class. Oh my God, I went over.
How much can I hold for exactly?
1605.
1605? It's gonna be push and pull.
It's gonna
It's a cushion
four. Okay, let's see.
See, I told you, it's just like, I have to, like, all the, like...
I love how you're correcting. That's really good. However, you should probably have stayed there. The round, I'm thinking with the college kids, may or may not happen. Hopefully it does, but be prepared. Be prepared to really never go there.
Well, it's just because my objective says that I want to, like...
It's gonna happen. It's gonna happen in the real world. It's sadly, okay? But I think to effectively get there is the beginning. Your questions, good. However, you started working around, like, the question... You made the question longer than it should have been.
Which one?
Like, the very first... See, I'm sorry, I'm trying
to... What's the round?
Remember. No, not the round. Welcome, kids. Remember what we learned today. Round, and history. That's fine, too. But... Do you remember... Here, I have horrible memory. Can you go over the questions you were going to ask?
Okay, so basically, obviously... hey, class, so last week we were talking about rounds at different time periods. The first thing is, who remembers what a round is?
Okay, are you sure? Who remembers what a round is? Just go straight to the question. I'll answer. You said something prior to that.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like I do that just to, like, out of nervousness sometimes. Like, I run out. That's something I need to work on. Like,
just go straight to the question, because they'll know it. Remember what a round is. It's the different parts, and you're going to say more or less the correct answer.
Yeah.
Okay? Then the next history. What are you going to say for the history?
And the history is, so last time we talked about the Renaissance period, so who knows what comes before the Renaissance period?
Do you guys remember we talked about the Renaissance? What comes before it?
Yeah.
Okay.
And then...
You, I guess this is not just play on words. You took a while getting to the word Renaissance.
Okay.
So get to and remember the Renaissance? What came before it? And see medieval, hopefully.
Okay.
Okay. Then what you stepped right into, you singing it first. Almost, we forget it. We forget it by the time we get to the round we're actually singing.
Okay.
A suggestion, this will vary depending on the energy of the group.
Uh-huh.
Go straight into the speak rhythm. Speak singing. Go straight to it. Okay?
So don't sing it at all.
Don't sing it. Don't sing it all until you get to singing.
Until we get singing, then
yeah.
I should.
You know, if you think about an eighth grade student, an eighth grader, he's going to be like, he's going to freak out first on words. He's like, any middle schooler is like, what is this Latin?
Is it fine that I went through the speak singing rhythm first? Meaning, like, I went through it, and then I said, okay, so just quickly back to the translation, so this is our translation.
Translation? That's actually a good thing, too. You keep that translation part. It's really nice to bit first. Remember the words even more.
Okay.
But it's the reinforcement of the words you have to get first. Me, I probably got it very easy. I don't know how the 246 is, because, you know, they may not have never read Latin in their entire life.
This is actually middle English, I should have.
I kind of
like glazed over that.
I guess it would. Oh yeah, because it's the okay. But I believe text is gonna be really crucial here, because if that doesn't go down, notes if the rhythm and the words don't come down, notes and round will never happen. But you harped on that. You really did. I want you to harp on it more.
Which one of the notes and words?
Huh?
Notes and words.
Rhythm and words, I'm sorry.
Okay.
Rhythm and words.
Did that make sense to you earlier how I said, guys, I want you to listen to my tone of voice, my timbre, and women, I want you to listen to the pianos. Just for like, it's for, because I'm in eighth grade right now.
I've never seen that. Well, thing is, I'm not versed too much in choir. Has your middle school teacher done that before?
Once, I've heard it once before, just because of that, like, because I don't want to, like, you know, I'm just thinking.
This is experience. This is totally experience thing.
So what is it called? To the single
Lord with said and Lord with men and speak Lord and Lord. This is a total experience thing. I don't know, but how I felt there is that, at least for me, I immediately went to the piano. Because for some odd reason, we trust the piano more than someone's voice.
Yeah.
At least that's just me. Be prepared for guys suddenly singing the higher octave. Going into falsetto.
No, that's why I'm gonna go so,
so,
and then for a moment, so, because
dead on women sing that.
So yeah, be prepared for not that the first note becoming a little edgy, but it should be quick.
Should I do that? I mean, I don't know. Maybe they'll get it as that, like the flow. Like I felt like I was like going back between going like this, and like sometimes you did just did it right after, and sometimes I was like ready go.
Oh, you have to be very explicit. But the problem is that here, sit down. This is what I remembered. We're gonna sing it. Sing. Girls are up here, guys just sing right down here. Ready, and where's my hands?
Over there.
You were back on your piano. You're gonna have to remember to step forward. Every time you direct the group, step forward and remind them that I was just here for a second, and over here.
I should put the piano more like...
Or yeah, put the piano even closer
so that,
to you if it's possible.
So that it's like more me like facing you guys like this at this
oh,
angle.
Oh, yeah.
And then like I can step out quickly. And then go back.
But I remember during that part, I didn't catch you with my eye. I didn't catch you with my eye.
But does it seem like it's well, like thought out?
Yes, of course. Yes, you have. I see your plan. I see your process.
Mm-hmm.
Now,
did you like that
experience?
That before the round, that like little exercise before the round where we had the first group perform and then stop when the second group enters.
Yes.
Just to clarify
that
they're entering at the beginning too, and you're entering as
that
normal.
Is, that was very clear. However, I was also worried about your conducting of it, but then that's really biased because you were both singing and conducting, and that's not hard enough.
Mm-hmm.
So just, you know.
I think I'm weaning off by that time. I'm going to wean off the piano by that time, I think. I'm going to put a stand right here for me so that I could just move back to here, so that when I'm done with it, I just get the note, and then we just go.
Okay, good.
Because like, yeah, that's what I meant. Like, I mean, I was like trying to get you guys to be like, oh yeah, and you're group two.
Good too.
And then yeah.
The anime, I love your energy, like especially when you come at us with assessments. Like, I was like, that's not exactly right. Here we go. Okay, let's repair, let's fix it. Okay.
Yeah.
You give that good energy. Give even that more energy to the directions. Okay, give exactly what you want. It was clear here, but you never know. Okay. You're doing great here. You're doing great, Ariel.
Garrett.
Sorry.
I was like, thank you, though. That was very helpful. Like,
it's at 3:30, right?
Yeah. But I'm just so worried, like, because I did go over time. But I don't know. Like, that wasn't like too bad over time to me. Like, it was just like maybe a minute.
I went under time. I was going. Apparently, my stuff is easier than I thought. So you just gotta prepare for that. No.
Mm-hmm.
Just try to catch yourself to not speak a lot.
So yeah, that's what I need to really. That's what I'm trying to do. Is like I'm trying to cut it so that I have more time going over because that takes up a lot of time. Like us going through the text.
So
and
it's those questions. Go directly at it.
And I think it's good that I cut it like this.
Yes, you did. That confuses me. You say wudenu, but I'm like, I see no you.
Oh, it's just how you say it. It's wudenu.
Okay. So be, I'm just going to be that
one
person
that's
going to ask.
Yeah, if there's no vowel, it's just going to be wudenu. Wudenu.
Okay, so just be ready for someone to, and remember said, grow with said and blow with med.
Grow with said. That's funny. You know where I got this piece from? From Bandcamp.
Oh.
From high school. Bandcamp High School. Choir.
Okay.
The Kuyamaka one.
Oh, wow.
You know Jason Pagyao?
Yeah, Pagyao.
Joseph, his brother?
Yeah.
His when he taught the choir at the Bandcamp, he gave us this music.
Oh, okay.
This was our music, and we like did like for the performance, we like walked in and we were chatting it and like around.
Okay.
Hey.
You're doing good, Ariel.
You want to do yours? I just did mine with Russell.
Okay.
We'll be here. Do you want to? Are you busy again?
Not so far.
Oh, shit. Okay.
I'm a little worried about that.
I just wanted to be
lesser than that. But yeah, if you guys want to run, that'd be awesome.
Yeah.
I'm too busy.
I'm gonna like volunteer to be the first one. I'm like getting this over with.
Yeah, it's a good thing.
Do you think it's too much to ask for 50 minutes to have Do you think it's too much to ask if you can have the whole class do one line and then the other line by the end? Not together?
Well, if they get the melody right, then.
Yeah.
Depending on
the
week. What are you reading?
The soprano line.
Alright, so. Here, let me time you.
Cool. No, I'm gonna look at it too.
How are you recording yourself? I need to know.
On your tablet.
I have my like phone, but I don't think it's gonna stay up, so I'm gonna ask someone. I think no one's gonna mind if I ask them if I use their device.
I'm conducting it in four.
Is there something wrong with the first measure, or is it just me?
It's
sounds
on
beat two.
Yeah.
So
it's
on
the text. I'm about to tell you about that.
I'm ready for you.
We're looking into the piece of it. It's like three feet big.
He prepared to. People are gonna like look at that and like, what?
Yeah.
I'm ready for you.
You ready for me?
I'm ready for you.
Okay. Alright. Hey, everybody. You are a middle school choir, beginning choir, but we've gotten through here, so you can read rhythms. You might not be so good at reading pitches, per se, but this is going to be a rote lesson. So this is more for the reference of for words and the rhythms. So here we go. This piece is called The Water is Wide. It's an English folk song. So what language is it in?
English.
That's right. But see, it's the same language, but it's sung a little differently. So mainly with the R consonant, you're going to say, the water is wide. It's going to be, the water is wide. Can you say, the water is wide?
The water is wide.
Very good. And then the next line will be, I cannot get bored.
I cannot get bored.
There we go. See, your American R's are disappearing. This is good for the English singing. I would like to go through the piece, just clapping the rhythms. Anybody notice something weird about the first line, though? Anything? I don't know.
I can't say that.
Oh, sorry, the first bar. The first bar is only three beats. I'm conducting this in four, so each bar should have a four-beat pattern, but there are only three. That's okay. At the very end of the piece, we have a bar with just one beat. That's where it makes up for us. See, they kind of stole it, put it at the end. So when I count you guys in, I'm going to give you a... Ready, go, the water is wide. So just look for the ready, go, and just come in on the beat. I would like you to speak and clap the rhythms. Okay? Ready, go.
The water is wide. I cannot get old.
Stop there. I'd like to point out something here. Neither have I wings to fly. We're going to be saying and neither have. Good, that's better. And the I wings to fly. Those are eighth notes there. So it'd be I wings to fly. Can we try that again? Just I wings to fly. Ready, go.
I wings to fly.
Again,
I wings to fly.
Perfect. That was much better. Okay, how about we fill some pitches in here? Get some music going. So our first note is the first me, then you. I'm gonna do just little sections at a time. The water is wide.
The water is wide.
let's put that together. First, me and then you again, give you a little refresher.
The water is wide, I cannot get over.
You guys got for me? Ready, go. Same interval as beginning with the notes. We go, but it changes a little bit. We're going to go descending minutes. So we're going to go, and neither have. Can you guys do that for me? Ready, go.
And neither have.
Okay, good. And neither have. I think I might be off on that.
And we shall cross.
close. Can you guys just do that part for me? And we shall cross. Ready? Go.
And we shall cross.
Okay. My true love and I. Just that section. Ready? Go.
My true love and I.
My true love and I.
My true love and I.
Good night. Alright, let's put the whole second half to do together. From give me a boat that can carry two. And I, and we shall cross, my true love and I. Here's your starting pitch. Can you just start from there and go on? Okay. Ready, go.
Give me a boat that can carry two. And we shall cross.
Try that one time. I'll sing it with you the first time, and then I'm going to have you guys sing it alone afterwards.
Yeah.
There's our starting pace. Yes. Oh, if I'm not working. Yeah, thank you. So, with me. Ready? Go.
The water is wide. I cannot get home. And I
sails the sea. She's loaded deep as deep can be. But not so deep as in love I am. I care not if I sink or swim. You think you guys can remember the melody and apply these new words to it? So outside of class aspect, do you think that that's too much to ask?
I'll keep going. Just keep going.
Okay.
I'll let you know.
Right. So we're going to try it again. The same melody. So I'll start ready, line two, sorry, line two, go.
There is a ship that sails the seas. She's loaded deep as deep can be, but not so deep as in love.
good ending? Any questions? Is that any question? Bothering something. At the beginning, so we got clarinets, guitar. Whirlies? Let me hear whirlies real quick. Let me hear whirlies real quick. Different speed, guys. Different speeds. I want one fast, one slow. Just change it up. Okay? The effect is this rushing wind. It's this wind in the background, as if it was blowing, the wind blowing over a hollow pipe. Different hollow pipes, because it's different hollow pipes. Okay? There you go. Okay? And just for a fact, I guess I'll step back. Actually, it sounds louder than I thought it would be. Let's go back. Go back. Let me hear. Nine, 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 cut. There you go. Okay. Right before no one.